Join me right now in welcoming to the program Academy Award winner Dean Pitchford. Dean, thanks for taking this time out. It's good to see you.
It's good to see you, Jim.
You know, when I say Academy Award winner, that must have a good ring to it, doesn't it?
It does. I like the way you just said that, you know.
Was that, I would imagine, a highlight for you? Winning the Oscar for fame.
Yeah, being born and that. Two highlights of my life. No, it was a terrific evening. It was a wonderful evening. The strange thing is that it usually happens as the culmination of people's careers. This happened to be my first picture. And you can't imagine how encouraging that is. But it was a terrific evening. I was not present for most of it. Mm-hmm. I think I was in Oshkosh. And the funny thing is, you know, after years and years of watching the Academy Awards on TV, I have learned to relate to it that way, mm-hmm. on the tube. But I certainly don't think of it as being an audience member and going up there and getting it. So I was numb through the whole procedure. And then that night, about 3 o'clock, I went home after all the festivities and the parties and stuff, and I was taking off my tuxedo, and I played back my video cassette because I had taped the program. And I sat there, and as I got closer to the moment, I got nervous. And my palms began to sweat, and my heart began to beat. And
what
when they announced
lose?
My name, I screamed, and I began to cry. I went through all those things that I used to go mm-hmm. through every year in watching the Oscars, because now I was seeing it the way that I was used to seeing it.
I've had people tell me that who were nominated, that if they didn't win, they were going to go up there anyway and take it. You know,
I understand that.
It's that emotional. You know?
Yes. I did the Grammys that same year because we were nominated for a Grammy for Fame. And we were on stage having just performed the song. Michael Gore and myself had just sung the song. And it was very close. You don't know how much. Just a few steps more and I could take that award mm-hmm. and I could walk away with it. The impulse is very strong.
Tell me about Footloose. Now you wrote the original screenplay and collaborated on the 9 new songs for mm-hmm. the film. How did the idea come about for the screenplay?
Well, the idea was it was a combination of things. After I had done Fame, I set about trying to come up with an idea for a musical that didn't necessarily have to happen in a show business setting. Didn't happen in New York, didn't happen in Los Angeles, backstage, on stage, in a recording studio, in a cabaret. Mm-hmm. People without stages listen to music. People move to music without needing a Broadway stage. So I thought, and I've always been fascinated by everything that goes on between the two coasts anyway. So I thought, that's the first task. Find a way to set a musical in the heartland of America. And the second thing was, how do I make music the subject of the film? You know, if you're doing a Broadway musical, it's natural how the music comes to be a subject. So at the same time that I was working on this idea, there was a great deal of number of groups all making their voices heard, coming out in favor of stricter moral codes, banning music, mm-hmm. banning records, banning books, burning records. That was very scary to me. And so I thought the way to make music, the focal point, is to make the music forbidden. And so when I had those two ideas, then I began to work on the idea of a kid from the outside coming and seeing a small town, which doesn't think twice about the fact that for years, they have just banned public dancing, rock and roll music, that kind of expression. Mm-hmm. And he brings a whole other perspective, and he can't believe that they're living like this.
You know, some areas may be really unaware that there are sections of the country that do such things, where dancing is, if not illegal, certainly tremendously frowned upon.
I found hundreds of cases where it may not be dancing, it may have been books being banned or taken off shelves, or it may have been records not being stocked in record stores because the local deacon had decided that that was not the thing to do. This community that I've constructed in Footloose is an amalgamation of those. I don't know that a community exactly like this exists, but certainly the communities with facets of this exist mm-hmm. all over the country. And it's hard for us in 1984 in our big cities to think that may be going on, but it does. And to hundreds of thousands and thousands of people, mm-hmm. it makes perfect sense because it's comfortable. It's the way that their lives have always been, and it's comforting to them. And this film is in no way an attempt to show up that particular style. I only come into conflict with it when it encroaches on individual freedom, a person's individual freedom.
All right. Now, you're touching on some really fairly heavy things there, yet the movie is in no way really a heavy film, in that you walk out feeling depressed by it. Totally other side, you go out feeling, I think, very exuberant about
bouncing
it.
Off the ceiling.
Yeah. So how did you walk that fine tightrope of balancing the two, a heavy subject on one hand, yet wanting the people to feel very up?
And a heavy subject is a heavy subject is only heavy when it's in generality. When it comes down to people, when it becomes down to specifics, it's much easier to deal with, and it's very understandable, and it becomes emotional. People believing in something, holding on to their beliefs, and the passion that makes them hold on to that belief is very touching, very human. Mm-hmm. And then when somebody is finally able to confront their beliefs and re-examine, re-evaluate. In the case of Footloose, there's a John Lithgow character who plays a minister who is very adamantly opposed to this type of rock and roll music and this kind of dancing. His daughter is a rebel, and this new kid moves in from out of town. The girl falls for the new kid, and the father, John Lithgow, has got to confront the fact that he can either go to his grave disapproving, or he can try to come to some kind of agreement, some kind of understanding. He may not adopt her way of thinking. He may not totally agree with her. And eventually, in the course of the film, she comes to some kind of understanding of what he is doing, mm-hmm. and why he's acting the way that he does. And it's those two generations reaching across the gap and trying to connect with each other that eventually gives the film its power and its humor and its emotionality. And then it's the musical numbers that give it its life and its energy.
And it was essential, I would assume, that you agree with Herbert Ross on the concept.
Oh, yeah. Oh, from the beginning. It's not like we walked into a room and we went, right, okay, and we agreed immediately. No, because we both have very strong opinions. And we went through a great deal of head knocking, you know, in the course of it. And I never thought I would, because I've always admired Herbert Ross. Yeah. He is one of the greats, one of the greatest directors in Hollywood. And I thought I would be totally in awe of him. And I was for the first couple of meetings, and then I realized that I had to say something or else he was not going to understand what I was thinking. And he was also very open to my input. So eventually we were getting into these real animated discussions about what it is that we wanted the mm-hmm. film to be. And then when we got to the music, it was a whole nother kettle of fish, because I was hearing things one way, he was hearing them another way, and we would push and pull and push and pull. Eventually what resulted as a result of all of that was better than what I would have done on my own, or what he would have asked for in the first place.
Well, I think most creative endeavors are fulfilled in just that way.
Yeah.
Because if they're not, the product, I think, inevitably suffers.
Well, Herb told me after 4 months of this kind of intensity, he said that he's never responded to people who say yes all the time, and not to be ashamed of the fact that I was saying no and that we were knocking heads over.
Yeah. Well, I think you've both done a fine job on Footloose, and I want to thank you very much for taking this time out to talk to me.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I do want to thank Kevin Bacon and Dean Pitchford for appearing on this Cinema Showcase, and a big thank you for watching. Until next time, good night.